thank Al for giving us an opportunity to see something that was really, really precious in our life. He's helping us to recapture an experience that my brother and I had many years ago. I think I would say this must be back, I would say 1969, around in that time, right around 1969. And we happened to have been, Jimmy had just moved over to 12th Street. And he was living over, he had this nice little beautiful, beautiful apartment. Because he, prior to that, he was living in this hotel, various hotels, and he was staying on a hotel on 50, he was staying in, what was the name?
59th Street.
He was staying in a hotel on 59th Street. I can't think of the name of the hotel. I passed by it, and I...
As a matter of fact, we went by it
I
once.
Think Deering Howe had something to do with this hotel, if I recall, because we used to go in there. Deering was, I think it might have been something to do with his family. But this was the hotel that Jimmy was staying in. And we used to spend a lot of time. And Jimmy finally had gotten his apartment on 12th Street. And
very happy about it.
Very happy about that. Mm-hmm. And we were all happy that he finally had his place in the city, because we felt as though this made him, you know, he was home. It was like made, he settled down.
We were happy about it because we thought, we said, you know, because Jimmy, being a traveling man, you know, we weren't sure exactly where he was going to settle down.
Right.
Although we know he always wanted to settle down in New York. Mm-hmm. But the fact that now that he had his apartment was really great. And I'll never forget.
The carpetbagger had landed, right, more or less. You right. know, and so, and we was happy about that. We used to spend a lot of time up there. You know, it was a real, real wild situation, really beautiful, because the apartment was really...
He finally got it decorated.
He got it decorated. We always felt, because Tunde and I was from the street, we had street decoration in our mind, you know, back in the day. You know, what was decorated to us was, you know, we was plush, super, super plush, you know, yeah. Super fly, I guess you would say, in that direction. But yeah, Jimmy...
You know, like carpet, big carpet, plush carpet. And don't forget, you know, you had to have a bar.
Yeah, the horseshoe bar and all of this kind
so
of stuff.
So, of course, we was expecting this Jimmy to have.
Jimmy, damn. I mean, if anybody's going to have the apartment of doom, it was going to be Jimmy.
So we couldn't wait for him to have it decorated. So
and invite us over. So he invited us over to the joint.
Finally,
when he invited us over to the joint, it, you know, this Moroccan style, you know, but we wasn't even into this. We wasn't in. Now, I mean, when I look back in retrospect, it was really beautiful. He had
quaint.
Beautiful. It was scarves, very simple. And, you know,
beautifully decorated.
Velvet stuff, you know, scarves over lions.
It was almost though he was in a Moroccan palace.
But wasn't what we was looking for.
You understand? To be honest
with
you.
But it was cool. But it opened our minds to another level of what our brother was all about. And that was cool. And we would go and spend a lot of time. We would spend a time in there. And one of the beautiful things that he would do, Jimmy, because...
Well, one thing, when you walked in, the ambiance was really great, because you walk in, when we come in, it was always some different music that was playing, because he always had his tape recorder, which was on a mantle. He had the tape recorder on a mantle in the living room, and you would always hear new... funky, real, way out music that was coming through. Something that you could really, really appreciate. So when we walk in.
So it was expanding. It was right. Mind expanding. It was indicative of the ambience. The music was indicative of the ambience
of the house.
And again, it was mind expanding. Now, we had just come back. I remember because we were in California. Me and Jimmy, Tunde had stayed in New York, and Jimmy and I went to California. And we were in California, and we did an article for the Rolling Stone. And while I was on my way to California, I had wrote a song, and the name of the song, it was, as a matter of fact, it was a song of the times. The name of it was called Flying High, and literally I had wrote the song because I was flying at the time.
And you had an experience.
And I had a very negative experience in the airplane, but I took the negative experience and I turned it into a positive situation, and it turned out to be this beautiful song called Flying High. And I wasn't really a songwriter. That wasn't really my thing, but this was probably one of the first songs that I had written. And to me, you know, like everybody, you know, it's your song, it's personal, and so I had gotten to California. When I got to California, I worked the song out in my mind, and I presented it to Jimmy. And when I presented it to him, he made me feel as though it was the best song in the world. That's how he was. You know, he sensed, he never made me realize that. You know, now, over the years, I must have wrote hundreds and hundreds of songs. I produced for New Kids on the Block. I produced for Rick James. I produced for, over the years, I've had hit records. I've done it all. And when I look back now,
at that simple song,
you know, coming from Hendrix, you know, saying how beautiful, you know, now, it taught me a big lesson about people and personalities and how beautiful this man was, because he made me think that I was probably the greatest writer in the world, and I was just a young kid with my first song, and I felt proud, and he made me feel proud. He made me feel good about this. So I told him about the song, and his joy was in seeing the joy as a young writer expressing this joy, and he emulated my feelings for the song. Now, by the time we got back to New York, I kind of forgot about the song. Got up into the apartment one day, Tunde, Jimmy, and I. And this man said to me, he said, remember that song? And I said, you know, I wasn't really sure what he was talking about. He said, that song that you wrote and that you played for me, that you were singing for me in California. And I said, I'm like, oh, yeah.
And then
he said, let's do that. Let's put that down on tape. And I was like flabbergasted. We all sat down.
He went to get
his little guitar. It was a little acoustic guitar. This beautiful little acoustic guitar with
stars.
It was like a pearl wrapping, something around it, and it was so beautiful. It was acoustic, and he started playing the song, and he made the song sound so fantastically beautiful. I couldn't imagine that the song could sound as great as it did. And I looked at what he was playing, and to be honest with you, he had a reel-to-reel in the apartment, and we did a couple of songs. We did a song called Gypsy Woman, Curtis Mayfield tune, and we did Flying High on that, and it was the most beautiful rendition of a song that as a matter of fact, I had to learn how to play it. That was the song because of my love for Jimmy. And because of that was the song that taught me how to play the guitar, because I always had that. I had that tape. And that was the tape that I burned the Midnight Oil on. I learned how to play the guitar off of that song, because I would say, hey, this is Jimmy teaching me. This was the gift that he gave me, as well as various guitars and things. But that was the gift that he gave me as to learning how to play the guitar through that song. And I always said to myself, well, here it is. He's showing me how to do it through this particular song. And that's hopefully what I'm getting ready to see right now, that guitar to bring me back 360 degrees back to that moment.
One other thing I just want to pick up on that, you know, that particular guitar was a guitar that Jimmy played most of all in the house. I mean, I almost as though it was a, we were going into a church. Mm-hmm. And I remember it now, you know, because of the look, the ambience, the smell. And you know, it's funny, when you think of Jimmy, the first thing you think of is a Fender, or you think of other guitars, maybe some electric guitar. So, but I don't ever remember.
Not in the church.
Right. I don't ever remember Jimmy playing an electric guitar
in
the house. It was always that acoustic guitar.
So, he slept with it.
Right.
He slept with that guitar. That was the guitar that he would use. That was his personal guitar. That was the guitar that he held close to him.
So if there's an energy of Jimmy that's out here in the all, a piece of it is inside of that guitar.
That's it. Well, I know one thing. Flying High is in it. So I like to see that guitar.
This is it.
You see?
Yeah. This is the pearl. See? This is the magic guitar, baby.
Wow.
This is it. You can look at this, baby. This is it.
How many years?
This has been, let me see, since 1960, 1969, 1970.
Wow.
36 years.
Now, of course,
36 years. Of course, you can't even, I wouldn't have even thought, thank you, Jimmy, because, you know, you couldn't even think of.
You want me to bring the high chair?
That was the idea. That was the first time I played that. I haven't even played that song, and that was the idea of how the song went. And it came off of this. Of course, don't ever think it's gonna sound like Jimmy. But that's it, baby. That's it. Mm-hmm. Idea anyway. I love it. Check, look at this piece.
Can you see that?
Yeah, you can zoom in on it.
I just zoom in on it myself.
Al, don't ever get rid of this. It even smells. You even got the smell.
You want to zoom in on those pictures that you were talking about?
Yeah,
tell us about
this
those
is
pictures.
There's one missing.
You see?
Do you have the other one, Tom?
No, this is just.
No, you have the
one of the. Yeah, I think I have something over here.
It was
right on the table.
It was.
And let's see. This is me when I was.
Tell the story.
This was.
Hold it up.
Yeah. This picture. Can you see that? Can you actually get in on that? That's is that me? Nah, that's Jimmy. That's me. In one of my incarnations, when I was Alpha Jerkin. We were getting ready to.
That's at Frank's restaurant.
This is a particular this was a restaurant called Frank's Restaurant. We were preparing to do the concert. Jimmy just came back from Woodstock.
We were doing a show in Harlem.
We were
getting ready to do the Harlem concert.
The Harlem concert.
And what you have there is just the photo of the press conference of the Harlem concert.
Right, and me young, and Jimmy's forever young.
And here's another photo. Hold this one up.
Oh yeah, this is me with that.
This
was the gift. This was one of the gifts that Jimmy had given me and Tunde. This particular guitar. This was the Black Widow guitar that I miss so much, because this is the guitar that I really learned how to really play the guitar from. And
right now the estate has the guitar.
Janie has it on loan in Seattle. Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. Right.
So if you ever go over to the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame,
you know this is the Ghetto Fighters guitar.
Right, and speaking of Ghetto Fighters, this is going to be a new project that we're working
on, right? This is a project that we're working on here. As you can see, Jimi Hendrix presents Ghetto Fighters. We still have some product of Jimmy's that we're working on, a very, very special project that we're putting together. And it's just about completed. We're just doing some touch-ups on it. I think Tunde and I have now mastered our ability to be able to be in that direction now and complete something that we worked on for many years with Jimmy, So I think that basically covers it.
So the last time you saw Jimmy play the guitar was when? When was the last time you had seen it?
Well, the last time I saw Jimmy play this guitar?
Yeah, when you were in the apartment every time on 12th Street.
The last time we saw it was right before Jimmy left for the Isle of Wight.
we had a meeting.
We had a meeting over there with Ken Hager, which was an attorney, and his partner. His partner was
Ed Howard.
Ed Howard. And Jimmy.
Devin and ourselves.
Taharqa and myself. And right before Hager and them and the meeting that we had, right prior to the meeting, Jimmy was playing this guitar.
Mm-hmm.
And that was before he left for Bow White.
That was the guitar that he used to calm himself down. It was like a calm down piece. It was a special piece. And there it is. That's the one. That's it.
So explain to me where it was in his bedroom. He walked in the
kept room. It right near the bed. Right near his bed. Either it was near his bed or it was on his bed. It was like, you see, you know, like this guitar stayed open. It was always ready. It was always something. It wasn't something that he kept closed in.
Not in the house. And this was like part of the furniture. Part of the happening, right? If you didn't see this guitar in the house, you didn't, you know, it was as though you weren't there.
So, when you said he did the song Gypsy Woman, he played it on this acoustic guitar too?
Yeah. Well, Gypsy Woman was a song by Curtis Mayfield. It's a hit song during that time, and it was something about the guitar work that Curtis did on that, which was a lot of hammering. And Jimmy loved the song, and he used to ask us if we knew the vocals to this song, you know, because he wanted us to sing it while he would play it. And it was an incredible rendition of it. We did the vocals, and he would play the guitar on it.
So that was the guitar that he used?
That was the guitar that he used to play, right.
Something else. Also, tell the story about how you were in the studio and Jimmy introduced you to Mountain at the record plant.
Oh, Tommy, you tell that one. Mountain and
Felix.
Yeah, well, I remember that one pretty cool. I can remember that very well because for two reasons. I'll never forget the car that we were in.
Jimmy had the... It was Faye Pridgen, because Jimmy had told Faye to bring her guitar because he was going to work. He was going to do some stuff in the studio with Faye that particular night. And so Faye had brought an acoustic guitar. To be honest with you, I wouldn't be, because I know that Jimmy had given her an acoustic guitar. And she had brought the guitar thing. And it was very close to this type of guitar as well. And she had brought her guitar to the studio. And he was going to produce a song. So they was working on, and Faye was on the side working on the song. It was a blues tune. She was getting ready to do this blues tune. And Jimmy was going to produce the album on her. We were at the record plant. And I remember very, very close, very clearly, because I'll never forget leaving. Now, when I walked out of the session, because I had to check our car, Tunde and I had a Cadillac. Jimmy had the Stingray. He had just bought this metallic Stingray. And he had this nice little Stingray. I think it was metallic, right? It was a metallic Stingray. And I had to go upstairs to check. There was a parking lot across the street from the place. And I had to go upstairs to check to find out if the car was okay. Maybe I just stepped out for a second. And I'll never forget passing by this particular studio that was across from us, directly across from us. And I kept on hearing this lick. And I said to myself, and they were playing some really heavy stuff in there. And somebody said it was this group, Mountain. And what really impressed me, first of all, the name Mountain. Who the fuck is this? Who the fuck is Mountain? You know? And then what I did was I said, damn, this is some really heavy stuff. Now, to be honest with you, it was on such a high level. Now, I'm over there with Hendrix. And to me, the stuff over there was complimentary. You understand? And you don't get complimentary to Hendrix, but this stuff was complimentary. And I'll never forget saying to myself, dun, 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 dun. You know, real, it was like one of those lines. It was just one of those lines that you'll never forget. And do you know, as time passed by, that particular song, he introduced us to the guys that was over there. He introduced us to this guy, Papillari, I think it was. Yeah, Jimmy introduced us to these guys. Jimmy introduced us because I think Jimmy went over there because he disappeared. We stayed over there with Faye because Faye was so happy. She was getting, and we was trying to help her to get her song together. Jimmy disappeared and went over to that side, to the other side, and stayed over there for such a long time that we had to go in there. When I came back down, he was still over there with Papillari and what's the other guy's name?
Leslie
West, right. Big guy. And
when we came over there, they were smiling.
They were smiling, and he introduced us to them and everything. And if anything, I don't know if Jimmy laid something down. He might have even laid something down over there. You understand? He might
Which
have
pissed Faye off, if you recall.
Because she was pissed off because she was waiting to get her song produced. And he wound up going over there and doing some stuff with them, if I recall. He wound up actually laying some stuff down with these guys over there. But Faye was very upset about that day. You know, poor
dude. Yeah, but it was cool. It was cool because when we got to meet the guys and listen to some of the music that they were doing over there.
Which was fantastic.
It was really fantastic, and we were all happy, you know. These are the guys. Amazing, you know. Al brought the CD around.
Felix, that's how I got the guitar, because when Felix got shot and killed by his wife, it was in his collection of instruments, and I had bought 13 instruments, and this was the guitar. This was one of them.
Wow. It's sad that he had to come back that way, but, you know. But here it is.
That's exactly how you remember it. The fretboard was just like that too, right?
Okay. Yeah, great.
Playing good today.
Well, you know what?
Really?
Just anything.
And he would just lay up there in the bed.
Just lay up in the bed and play.
Play that.
Just play this. Lay up in the bed like it was his woman.
You said he ate and slept with this.
This was the guitar. Ate and slept. This is what he lived.
Would you say it was one of his favorite guitars?
I would think it had to be, because he spent most of his time with this.
This is the home guitar.
This is homegrown. This was the one that, this is now I could see as a guitarist now, over the years now, I could see why. Because first of all, it offers resistance. It's like a woman. This particular guitar is not easy. It's a very, very, however, it has, it's...
If you can master it, you got a good piece of pussy.
Good piece of pussy, because you know it's yeah, because see, one thing about this guitar, it's not the, you know, like you have to really, once you really play this guitar and you spend time with it, it demands time. It's a demanding. However, it keeps you wanting to touch it because it's so easy to touch. That don't mean that it's easy to play. It's easy to touch. It feels good. It has a good feeling. It feels warm, and it invites you to touch it. It invites you to play with it.
But
you've got to really know how to really master it. And he had mastered this. He had mastered this guitar. And this is the type of guitar you can, like, you could have your little strats and all of that kind of stuff all around you. But you could really, because after you get off of this, you're going to play anything much better. This is one of those type of guitars. I would never, never let this guitar under my sight.
So did you see him do any other songs besides the Flying High?
Oh, I've heard him play songs. But of course,
I can't remember
what. I've heard songs and melodies come from it. But these are the songs that I could actually say I know, you know, came out of it. You know, I songs, pieces, melodies, ideas came from it. But this is definitely, those are the songs that I know, he played because they were personal. It was a personal relationship with those particular songs. Other things, I just listened to them play. But these were personal because we worked together. We worked on the songs. We recorded those with this, on this.
And you said you have a reel to reel.
I have a.
You have a reel to reel tape of Jimmy playing this guitar.
I have a reel to reel to find that. One of my four ables, one of our four ables back at that time was, you know,
thinking that we were all invincible.
This is a black man's foible. You understand?
We think we live forever.
And when we are young, you know, people be taking pictures around you. You don't take pictures. You never know who you're actually with. You know, so we don't document things. Yeah, that's why black, but even in Africa, we griots. Instead, we griots. We have oral history. We deal with the history from an oral perspective, though there was a time when we were very conscientious. Our ancient selves was very conscientious, and of course we have written history. But later on, as we became migrants throughout Africa, we became more, because we were constantly moving and constantly gypsies. We were the true band of gypsies. And so through that traveling, we became less conscientious writing things because we had the concept
of history writing.
And all the way up until this very day, that's one of the things that some of us have got to be more conscious of, recognizing the moment and taking full advantage. They say God is the master of the day, master of the moment.
Well, that's why you notice at the young ones now, they deal with documentary. And they're dealing with that.
Young,
we had to pass it on,
because we didn't. It's
the future.
Yeah,
it's the future.
One thing that Jimmy did, Jimmy was the first one of us that had it. He had his little 8mm, you know, and he was taking pictures. He started to try and start getting into the documentation of the moments that we were sharing. And where those films are, I don't know. You know,
but they certainly exist.
But you have the reel to reel.
I had the reel to reel.
Jimmy playing this guitar.
Playing the guitar. Now, whether I actually can put my hands on it or not, that would be the $64,000 question. You know, can I actually get it? Can I actually resurrect that particular tape?
And perhaps we can.
And perhaps I can. I will certainly, as my situation moves towards those directions, I'm certainly exploring that possibility of being able to get that, you know. So if I do, I'll certainly let you hear it. It's remarkable. That would be my greatest joy, to be able to let you hear that.
All right. Okay. All right, that'd be good. Thanks, man. I appreciate
Thank you. I'm sure once it's all edited, it'll be excellent.
Yeah, no, that was good just the way it was.
You should let me hand this guitar to you. Can I hand this to you?
Yes, you can.
Because if I don't, I don't want to keep it.
Proud to have it back.
Now, don't ever let it get away,
no,
okay?
No doubt, thanks.
And we want to know, if you do, we want to be the first to buy it.
No, if you ever want to use it in the studio, let me know. I'll never sell it. I sold it once to Steven Seagal, the actor, for $80,000, and I just bought it back and traded three guitars valued at $215,000 to get it back. So to me, it's priceless.
I think that's
my favorite guitar out of my whole guitar collection.
Wow. I think that's. And what kind of collection do you have?
I got a collection of Fender pre-CBS custom color Strats and 59 Les Pauls.
What's the value of all of the
collection? $2 million. Right. Probably about $4 million worth of guitars, 35 instruments. And this is my favorite guitar.
Right. What started you on your collection?
When I was a kid, I took lessons from Leslie West at Mountain. And from there, you know, I always wanted to emulate my heroes, and they had all different good guitars. And I had known about this guitar because Leslie West of Mountain had told me that Felix Pappalardi had a guitar that the guitar that Felix had that Jimi Hendrix had given to Eric Clapton. Mm-hmm. It was called the Stahl Acoustic. So after Felix got killed, Leslie kept talking about, I want to get Felix's instruments. There's this one guitar that was Eric Clapton's, and there's a Hendrix connection to it. So I got it, and I never really found the right people that could document it, because there was a picture in Life magazine of Jimmy playing the guitar, but the picture's been airbrushed, so it really wasn't easy to authenticate. Mm-hmm. But once I met you guys and Amaretta Marks, I was convinced that the guitar is definitely Jimmy's guitar, and that's what.
But at that time, you had already given it to Seagal.
Yeah, I had already. Well, my father passed away. And I wasn't thinking right, and I had some debts from a recording studio, recording an album, and I sold it to him for $80,000, and it bothered me for years that I had sold it. And then after I met you, I showed you the picture of the guitar, and you said it was it. Then it sent me on the quest to get it back.
The Holy Grail.
Yeah, because see how this all
did came. Did you have any problems? Getting it back?
Yeah, it took me a year of going back and forth to get it. You see, what happened was, I purchased one of Jimmy's guitars. It was a lefty Fender Strat that was also that I showed you that you also documented with Jimmy. And so we met up to talk about that. And then from there, I had showed you the picture, and you was like, whose guitar is this? And then I told you that I'd sold it to Steven Seagal, and he says, we'll get it back because this is Jimmy's, bedroom guitar. And thank God that I met you guys and you put me on a quest to get it back. And, I could promise that it will never leave our side again.
Okay, great.
Good, definitely. All right, great. Mm-hmm. All right, well, I'll let you guys go. Thank you for a great night.
Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Cameraman, for all the help. Appreciate it.